One of the most famous action scenes in the history of motion pictures, the great chariot race of Ben-Hur. In 1959, this was the most expensive ever made. And for the post-war era, one of the longest, running almost 3.5 hours.
Ben-Hur, world's most honored picture.
Ben-Hur would go on to become a box office triumph and win more Academy Awards than any other motion picture ever made. 11 in all. It would also save a studio from bankruptcy. But long before Charlton Heston and Stephen Boyd clashed wheel rims, in the Circus Maximus, the story of Ben-Hur had already thrilled generations of silent movie audiences. And even before then, captivated the theater and publishing worlds. But for today's audience, it is this big screen version that they remember best. The latest incarnation of a story that has enthralled the world for more than a century. At the heart of this timeless tale is Judah Ben-Hur.
You're a Roman, and I'm a Jew, whose life you once saved.
The best thing I ever did.
Born a Judean prince, Ben-Hur is betrayed by his boyhood friend, Masala, and becomes a slave.
Your eyes are full of hate. 41. That's good. Hate keeps a man alive.
Many people think that the character of Ben-Hur and perhaps Masala and some of the other people came from the Bible. But in reality, there is no Ben-Hur in any of the Gospels or any part of the New Testament.
The character of Judah Ben-Hur first came to life in the mind of a Civil War hero, General Lew Wallace. Wallace, a successful lawyer, who had also served as governor of New Mexico Territory and an Indiana state senator, had already penned one book. On a night in 1876, Wallace decided to write a novel that would begin with the three wise men on their way to Bethlehem to seek the newborn Christ child. But Wallace would add a twist to his story about the three kings. He would also write about a fictional prince of Judea. His name, Judah Ben-Hur.
You're a prince among your people. You're rich and you're powerful. Your reputation is stainless. And the people would listen if you were to speak out against rebellion. Judah, persuade your people that their resistance to Rome is stupid. It is worse than stupid, futile. For it can end in only one way, extinction for your people.
Now this is Ben-Hur, A Tale of the Christ, is Lew Wallace's title. But it isn't a tale of the Christ. It's a tale of a war between a Roman boy and a Jewish boy.
Wallace chose to examine the political and religious turmoil at the time Christ lived.
So he came up with the idea of Judah Ben-Hur and Masala, the opposing forces for the conflict.
Either you help me or you oppose me. You have no other choice.
If that is the choice, then I am against you.
There's Masala.
Rome furnished the politics and made the evolution of Masala easy.
I'm not mad. I'm not a murderer.
I know you're not.
You are evil.
No, Judah, I am not evil. I wanted your help. Now you've given it to me.
When he started writing Ben-Hur, General Wallace had no particular religious feeling. But then something happened to change his mind.
He had an occasion to meet on a train trip this Robert Ingersoll, the great agnostic, I believe they refer to him as. He repudiated God, heaven, Jesus Christ, as far as the divinity is concerned.
The general, taken aback by Ingersoll's virulent agnosticism, began rethinking his story.
Lew Wallace, who was neither a believer or a non-believer at that particular time, decided that he was going to make the case for the divinity, culminating, of course, with the crucifixion at the end and the conversion of Ben-Hur to Christianity.
After almost 5 years of writing, Wallace's book was published in 1880. It was not an instant success. But after 2 years, sales took off, and Ben-Hur became a publishing phenomenon. And like the hero of his tale, General Wallace had also become a believer. By 1882, Wallace was inundated with offers to adapt his bestseller for the stage. But the newly religious general was concerned how the Christ figure would be treated.
He held out. He was afraid, because of the religious theme, that it wouldn't be treated properly.
Finally, two theatrical producers, Mark Claw and Abraham Erlinger, hit upon an idea that convinced Wallace. Claw and Erlinger would not use an actor to represent Christ on stage, but instead a shaft of intense white light. Wallace liked the idea, and Claw and Erlinger now had one of the hottest theatrical properties of the time. But they had to tackle a much more practical problem: how to stage two of the book's most thrilling scenes, the Great Sea Battle and the Great Chariot Race. The solution for the race was to put huge treadmills on stage and run live horses on them, all the while rolling an endless canvas backdrop behind them.
As the years went by and the show became even more spectacular, they added more chariots and more horses. And I know that at one count, apparently they were up to at least 5 chariots, if you can imagine that on a stage.
Claw and Erlinger invested an unheard-of sum of $75,000 to dramatize Ben-Hur, and their investment paid off. Ben-Hur, the play, grossed an unprecedented $10 million during its 20-year run, and more than 20 million people saw it on stage.
They had music, they had a chorus singing throughout this. They had all these big scenes, including the sea battle, with cloth representing the sea, people off stage doing the number with the cloth, and with motorized waves and what have you. It was truly a major production.
Religious leaders jumped on the Ben-Hur bandwagon and urged their congregations to get out and see the play. People even had chariot races at county fairs. But during its long run, the play did not always go as planned.
One night in Boston, because of the treadmills not operating properly, Missala won the race. And of course, they couldn't change the text of the play. So because of this, they just carried right on as though Ben-Hur had won.
During its run, some of the country's top actors vied for a role in the most heroic saga of the Judean prince, Ben-Hur. But the only cast member to complete the entire 20-year run was an Arabian horse named Monk, who just happened to belong to General Wallace. After the turn of the century, a burgeoning new art form was also eager to capitalize on the success of Ben-Hur. Celluloid art was still in its infancy in 1907 when the Kalem Company shot the very first film version of Ben-Hur. Rather than going to the trouble and expense of staging their own chariot sequence, the filmmakers headed to Manhattan Beach, New York, where horses and firemen from the Brooklyn Fire Department were performing a chariot race as part of a fireworks show. The film was billed as 16 magnificent scenes with illustrated titles, positively the most super motion picture ever made.
The motion picture, a one-reeler, was only about 15 minutes long. A standard length film for that time.
But it was quite significant, not only making history as the first film depiction of the famous chariot sequence, but also setting a legal precedent for copyright infringement. Lew Wallace had died in 1905, 2 years before the film was made, and his family had assumed ownership of the rights for the story. When they heard about the Kalem Company's film, the heirs sued, claiming the film's producers had failed to get permission from the Wallace family. The suit went all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court, where the heirs won. The court ordered the Kalem Company to pay $25,000 to the Wallace family. Writers today can thank Ben-Hur for the copyright protection they enjoy with regard to any film version of their work. By the 1920s, the film industry had come a long way. Silent pictures were in their heyday, and filmmakers were eager to make the supreme motion picture masterpiece of all time, a new, longer version of Ben-Hur.
It was a colossal success, and everybody saw the 1925 Ben-Hur. It was, again, it was something you had to do. In prestige and in recognition for a new company that was just being put together at that time, to have this as one of their early releases really consolidated their position.
Even though the film was immensely popular, it would be almost 6 years before this version of Ben-Hur turned a small profit.
The final cost of the film, after all the chips were in, was $4 million. Now remember, this is 1925. $4 million was unheard of. An expensive, a very expensive picture in those days would be $1 million. It finally was in the black just barely with a 1931 reissue where they added synchronized music and effects so that it became a sound picture of sorts.
The studio which acquired the rights to General Wallace's story was Goldwyn Pictures in California. Wallace's son Henry had reluctantly sold the rights to a group of investors who in turn made a complicated profit-sharing arrangement with the Goldwyn studio. J.J. Cohen traveled to Italy to see if they should make the motion picture there.
I was a production manager in 1925. I went to Rome before 1925. I came over here with Columbus. I went over to see a man. He didn't think any picture in the world should cost more than $200,000.
The filmmakers packed up and headed to Rome in January of 1924 to make what would be one of the most expensive and troubled productions of the entire silent era.
There were just a multitude of problems. The fascist and anti-fascist element, Mussolini had come into power. There were constant strikes. There was one group pitted against the other group. They couldn't get things accomplished. Things were taking much longer to build, to get ready. There were these warring factions. And, of course, a lot of the people wanted the shoot to go on forever over in Italy because they figured this was a great way to pick up some good money.
Back in California, the Goldwyn Company was in the process of merging with Metro Pictures and Louis B. Mayer Productions. The success or failure of the newly formed MGM was riding on one thing, the problem plagued Ben-Hur.
Louis B. Mayer, in charge of the studio, and Irving Thalberg, the legendary Irving Thalberg, as his right-hand man, they suddenly inherited this, this major catastrophe, and they quickly decided something that had to be done. Well, the first thing they did, after watching some of the dailies that were sent over from Italy, was to change the director. They put Fred Niblo on, who had worked for Mayer, and it was a known quantity. They felt that George Walsh, who had been cast in the role of Ben-Hur, was really not right.
After having earlier considered Rudolph Valentino, cowboy star Buck Jones, John Gilbert, and dozens of other matinee idols, Ramon Novaro was finally chosen to replace George Walsh as Ben-Hur. Virtually the only members of the original team to remain were Francis X. Bushman, who played Masala, and Carmel Myers, who played Masala's mistress. An unknown 19-year-old actress named Myrna Loy was added to the cast as an extra. The new cast and crew took a ship over to Europe and arrived in Rome in June of 1924. Production started over from scratch. MGM had harnessed all of the technology and magic of the movies to make the film a hit. In making this groundbreaking epic, Frank Williams designed the collapse of a Roman palace with his innovative traveling mat effect. To enhance certain scenes, the producers experimented with an early version of Technicolor, the two-color process, which did not render a true blue or a yellow. It seems that the director even felt the women needed enhancement. In this letter to studio head Louis B. Mayer, director Niblo complained that the local Italian extras were heavy and unattractive. He wanted to import women from Paris for the Daphne scene. These were the days before the Hayes Office censorship. For the extraordinary sea battle scenes, the art directors had full-size galleys built in Italian shipyards. But that's when the problems on the Italian shoot really heated up.
Then they started in the naval battle, an actual battle that was taking place at sea, and there was supposed to be a fire of sorts on the main flagship. They had oil cans on fire, they had smoke things and what have you, but suddenly, because of the wind factor coming up through the oar holes, the draft that was created started the whole ship to blaze in a hurry, and all of the extras immediately decided to dive into the water. And this was not a tank, remember, this was in the ocean. Well, some of the extras, of course, who had said, yes, of course I can swim, the old story, you know, when you're interviewed, can you swim, can you ride a horse, yes, and that. Well, in this case, a lot of them couldn't. So they ended up in the water, and there were legends about that they actually lost some of these people and who weren't rescued. We don't really know. But that footage is in the picture. You do see that fire, and you see these people, you know, leaping overboard.
And it wasn't just the extras that experienced some real drama. Ben-Hur himself bore his own battle scars. In a 1961 interview, Ramon Navarro remembered shooting the fiery scene.
Well, yes, in the exterior they had a very, effective scene. They had a camera over an awning, started burning, and as soon as the hole was large enough, it revealed me on the mast. And I jumped through the burning hole to save Arion's life. I still have a few marks on my body of the burning hole.
Isn't that so?
Yes.
This unexpected debacle was the last Roman straw for the studio executives. Louis B. Mayer and Thalberg ordered the entire cast and crew back to Culver City to complete the picture. New sets were constructed. The call went out for thousands of extras for the mammoth chariot scene. Motion picture history was about to be made.
The chariot race, of course, was a major event. It was at the corner of Venice and La Cienega Boulevard, which at that time was a huge open lot. And they had built this big arena. They had all these extras in on a Saturday. They had all of the notables of Hollywood coming down, the Doug Fairbankses, the Mary Pickfords, the Harold Lloyds, they were all coming down to watch this. It was kind of like a big circus.
MGM hired 42 cameramen for 42 cameras, more than Hollywood had ever used or would use again. There were cameras everywhere, cameras on towers that looked like oil derricks, cameras on flatbed trucks, cameras concealed inside statues, behind shields, cameras on mobile platforms, and camera cars. J.J. Cohen was there that day.
Mr. Thalberg came down and was a little worried that we didn't have enough people. I thought we did. We had close to 3,000, if I remember rightly. And we added some more just to make sure. And we had to get lunch for them. So I told the assistant director to put the horses on the track so we'd be ready for them. Mr. Niblo didn't want to do it. Of course, he said the lunches hadn't been there. I said, get the horses out on the track. He said, we'll have a riot. I said, it'll look as if they're cheering the race.
Still, the producers did not think the crowds were big enough. The new Circus Maximus, built in California, had to dwarf any previous set built in Rome. So it was up to the art directors to compensate.
When they did the chariot race, for example, where you see what looks like thousands and thousands of people, you did have a lot of extras. But the top half of that Circus Maximus is a miniature that's hanging in front of the camera in which there are little dolls that are moved on dowels so that you get a sense of movement there, so that the set looks twice as big, if not more, and it looks like there are three times as many people there than were actually there, and there were a lot of people there.
To add some real excitement to the chariot sequence, the producers offered the rodeo stars and horse wranglers driving the chariots an added incentive, $5,000 to the winner. And excitement they got.
Well, they did get a big crash. That crash is in the final picture. It wasn't staged, it was an accident, and there was a tremendous pileup of men, chariots, and horses. And when you watch it, it's really something to behold. As to how many people were hurt, certainly horses were hurt. It's hard to say, because once again, they weren't releasing that kind of material at the time.
We had every assistant director we could lay hands on to help in the shooting of the big scenes.
One of the assistant directors attempted to prevent the pileup by trying to warn the oncoming chariots as they came around the bend of the Spina. Another assistant director on hand to help wrangle the massive chariot sequence was a young William Wyler, who 33 years later would have another encounter with the epic Ben-Hur.
Generation after generation of readers have been thrilled by Ben-Hur. No book save the Bible has ever been so widely read. Now, as a motion picture, Ben-Hur has inspired enthusiastic acclaim in every corner of the earth.
The year is 1958. Again, MGM turned to Ben-Hur to save the once mighty studio from the brink of bankruptcy.
This is the 50s. The movies are getting desperate. They're losing their audience to television.
You had these big religious spectacles, and those were the pictures that were doing extremely well at that time. The average picture, for the most part, the run-of-the-mill picture, was not drawing particularly well in the theaters.
I crown their god.
A cutter on the silent version, Sam Zimbalist, would return to produce the colossal picture.
Sam was one of their most successful producers. Certainly he was the nicest. And Sam was a scientist with the understanding that if you don't pull this thing off, we'll give you all the money you need, but if this doesn't come off, there is no studio.
Zimbalist convinced his friend, William Wyler, to take on the massive project. Wyler had already directed such important films as Jezebel, The Best Years of Our Lives, and Wuthering Heights. Now he was ready for a change of pace, as he recalled in a 1981 interview.
The producer of Ben-Hur came to me and said, how about doing Ben-Hur? I thought it would be intriguing to see if I could make a Cecil B. DeMille picture. So I took on the job. It was in line with my desire to make every kind of picture.
Well, my father used to joke that it took a Jew to make a really good movie about Christ. And he wanted to make a movie that a broad audience would like, irrespective of their religious beliefs.
But I've heard of a young rabbi who says that forgiveness is greater and love more powerful than hatred. I believe it.
Esther.
Judah.
Wyler had a reputation for being very slow and being a perfectionist, and dealing, of course, with more intimate dramas. But that's exactly why Zimbalist wanted him.
And Zimbalist wanted Wyler badly enough to offer him $1 million, the most any director had been paid up to that time.
Also, I thought this picture could make a lot of money, you know, and maybe I'll get some of it, which I did.
Once again, the MGM studio headed to Rome to begin the new epic.
And it was a big, lumbering production that needed a lot of work and a lot of attention. And there was about an American crew of about 125 or 130 people over there.
For an entire year, Ben-Hur was the biggest film production anywhere in the world, with a cast of literally thousands and more than 300 sets, some of which were under construction a full year before the first frame of film was ever shot. Art director Edward Carfagno was one of the first to arrive to supervise construction of the sets. Years of research had gone into their elaborate design. The massive sets would eventually win Carfagno an Oscar. He and his then 19-year-old son, Edward Jr., documented much of the early production with their home movies.
My father knew he was going to be there for quite a while, so had it arranged that we would go over and live with him while he was there. So we were going to go to school. I think he was proud of the whole thing. The set for Arias' party was quite a spectacular set. That came off very well. Actually, that set took up pretty much all of a stage. The fountains worked, and it was quite large. Things like Ben-Hur's house, that was on a wood frame with stucco that was then dressed to and painted to look like stone. The stadium bottom, as I recall, 7 feet of the walls surrounding the course were built of stone, because the chariots were so heavy. If they had runaways, that was, I think they weighed about 700 pounds apiece. That was quite a thing to try and stop, so that was stone.
The city of Jerusalem alone covered 10 square blocks, including the massive gate of Joppa. By the time the sets were completed, the construction crews had used 40,000 cubic feet of lumber, more than 1 million pounds of plaster, and 250 miles of metal tubing. 40,000 tons of white sand were carried in from the beaches of the Mediterranean. Meticulous research also went into the dressing of the sets.
One funny thing happened with the art department. I took a friend of mine, an archaeologist, to see the sets. And we went into Mrs. Ben-Hur's kitchen, and there in the kitchen was a very large, ripe tomato. And my friend said, he was an English guy. Tomato's not been invented yet, you know. I said, what do you mean it's not invented? Well, it comes from the New World, you know, with Columbus. Wouldn't be a tomato. So I talked to the art man. He said, I've got to have something red there. I said, try a pepper. Not invented, said the Englishman. They hadn't invented red peppers. I don't know what we had that was red there, but there was something red on that table. And then they were so proud, and announcements were going out, this Jerusalem is the Jerusalem of Jesus Christ. He could move through this city and feel that he was absolutely at home. He would know where to go and order a pizza, which, by the way, was a contemporary dish.
Rather than shooting the sea battle on the open ocean, which had proved disastrous in the 25 version, Carfagno supervised the digging of a man-made lake. They even built sections of two Roman galleys. It took 300 oarsmen to power each of these massive battleships.
Steersman, ram course. Order below, ramming speed.
Ramming speed!
Steersman right.
Water is one of the most difficult illusions, and it was quite successfully done in the sea battle of Ben-Hur. The miniatures were quite large. It was done in a big tank with underwater tracks, and these tracks would then move the ships along.
Costume design was elaborate. Silk, jewelry, armor, and lace were ordered from all over the world. After spending a year in England embroidering woolens and tooling leathers, the designers moved their headquarters to the Cinecittà studios in Rome, where more than 100 seamstresses, armorers, and leather makers were employed. With work on the sets and costumes well underway, Producer Sam Zimbalist, director William Wyler, and the rest of the production staff traveled to Rome to begin shooting. But there was a slight hitch, the script.
They'd also built Charlton Heston out of solid balsa wood. There he stood, greeting us warmly, surrounded by paparazzi. And there's no script. And there's a start date. And the studio is slowly going down the drain.
Now, Sam did show me the script where Willie had written into the margin, terrible, awful, rewrite.
Over the years, MGM had accumulated more than 40 scripts for Ben-Hur, and it was a screenplay written by Carl Tunberg that Wyler carried to Rome.
I certainly remember him agonizing over the screenplay, as he did over every screenplay he worked on.
Tunberg had a script, a completed script, which everybody agreed on. Then they got over to Rome, and Willie started looking at the script and decided there were a lot of things in it that he didn't like.
Gore Vidal, already under contract to MGM, was hired to revise it.
So Sam turned to me, and he said, "Will you have a go at it?" I said, "I would rather die, Sam." And I said, "This is a piece of junk." He said, "I know, but," he said, "I'm asking you as a personal favor." And I said, "Love only goes so far in the movies. Will you let me out of the rest of my contract?" I had 2 more years to run. He said, "Yes, if you come to Rome with William Wyler and me in April." We started in on the script, and at one point I had done about 10 versions of the scene where the two boys meet. I said, "Willie, let's try something here. Let's make it a lover's quarrel."
"Judah, we must believe in one another. Will you drink to that?"
"With all my heart." Willie had it. One ear was deaf, and the other he could hear. When he didn't like what you were saying, he would turn this way, and he didn't hear a word. When I said lover's quarrel, I suddenly got the good ear, swung my way. He said, "What do you mean?" I said, "Well, could it be that the two boys had had some sort of emotional relationship first time around, and now the Roman wants to start up again, and Ben-Hur doesn't, and doesn't get the point?" Willie said, "Gore, this is Ben-Hur. You can't do that to Ben-Hur." I said, "Well, if you don't do something like that, you won't even have Ben-Hur. You're going to have a motiveless mess on your hands." And he said, "Well, you can't be over." I said, "I'm not going to be over it. I'm not going to give, there won't be one line. But I can write it in such a way that the audience is going to feel that there is something emotional between these two, which is not stated, and which blows the fuse in Masala.
Beg!"
That he is spurned.
"Didn't I beg you?"
So it's a love scene gone wrong. And then over the years, the subject would come up, and I would mention this. Well, he said, "That isn't true." And he said, "I don't remember we ever had that discussion." And this was has become a famous point of contention between Wyler and me.
Eventually, British playwright Christopher Fry was called in to rewrite much of the dialogue.
So Sam Zimbalist, the producer, and Christopher started rewriting much of the script behind Willie's shooting. He'd shoot one day what they wrote the previous day, and they were just a jump ahead of the devil all the time with him.
He was very keen for the language to reflect the times and the fact that this is a story that was actually taking place 2,000 years ago, so that the language not be current language, but also not be, ridiculous sounding, that it have some poetry to it. What Christopher Fry was doing was changing a line like, "How was your dinner?" to, "Was the meal to your liking?"
"Was the food not to your liking?"
"Indeed."
Thank you.
Nevertheless, despite all the rewrites, it was the original screenwriter, Carl Tunberg, who would go on to receive sole writing credit for the film.
Wilder went before the Screenwriters Guild to say that the script had been written by Christopher Fry. He wanted Fry to have sole credit because I had left, and Fry had stayed with him for 6 months. Fry, like a gentleman, said, well, I can't take credit for what Gore's written, and Gore wrote everything up to the chariot race. So it should be a co-credit. Wilder said, fine. Next thing we know, the Screenwriters Guild arbitration has said this is the sole work of one Carl Tunberg.
I think Wilder got upset and sort of crusaded against him winning an Oscar. He was nominated, but he didn't win.
Despite the tremendous pressure behind the scenes, the producers and the cast put up a relaxed and glamorous front. And the allure of this blockbuster in the making drew everybody to Ben-Hur. Everybody who was anybody, from Betty Davis to Kirk Douglas to Ed Sullivan, visited the set in Rome. And the hottest ticket in town was a ride in the chariot. Even the Italian aristocracy was caught up in Ben-Hur fever and jockeyed somehow to be included in the production. For this scene, the Duchess Nona Medici and Count Marigliano were among the real noble names cast.
All of Rome knew that Ben-Hur was being filmed at this studio called Cinecittà. And I think that when he decided to cast the party scene, he thought, well, the aristocracy of Rome went to that party then, and they should come to this party now. They certainly will know how to behave.
Charlton Heston as Ben-Hur at the reins of his chariot. It is difficult to imagine anyone else in the role.
Heston was never on the list. The first people Metro wanted was Paul Newman, who had just made his second or third picture at Warner Brothers. Paul had been in a biblical epic called The Silver Chalice, in which he was terrible, and the picture was terrible. So I was delegated. Newman and Joanne Woodward and I were all living out at the beach at Malibu. I was delegated to get Newman to play Ben-Hur. Paul said, never again will I act in a movie in a cocktail dress. That's just not for me, he said, and besides, I don't have the legs for it.
For Ben-Hur, at one time or another, Marlon Brando was considered, Kirk Douglas was considered, Burt Lancaster, Rock Hudson.
Then they did something that I have never seen a major studio in that period do. They had an open call.
Turn around.
Anybody could test for Ben-Hur if they could pass through the assistant directors.
Have you ridden a lot?
Since I was about four.
Have you? You ever driven a chariot?
Never, yet.
So they tried everybody, and there was still no actor, and they were still building the sets.
The actors, given more careful consideration, took screen tests. Here, Leslie Nielsen plays Masala against Cesare Danova as Ben-Hur.
I'm afraid I can't down Eros with much conviction anymore. Met too many charming ladies to go about insulting the god of love.
The picture my father made just before Ben-Hur was The Big Country, and Charlton Heston had a leading role in that. At whatever point he realized that he'd just worked with somebody who was perfect, for Ben-Hur, it must have been a great relief to him. And I do remember when he first agreed to do Ben-Hur and was first looking for the actor to play Judah Ben-Hur, that there were a certain number of Italian strong men whose pictures arrived at the house. And there was some consternation about the fact that, could they speak English? What was their accent like? And they did have a beautiful body, but I really wasn't going to be enough.
When I was a boy, I dreamed of commanding this garrison.
Stephen Boyd was cast opposite Heston as the Roman Masala. The young Irishman was a relative newcomer to the screen.
He was a rather enigmatic young man with that sort of Irish look that he could do anything, which really helped the part
particularly as I saw the part.
But the blue-eyed Boyd would have to play the part with brown eyes, decided director Wyler after taking a look at his cast.
But he suddenly realized that he'd cast all these blue-eyed actors. Just seemed as though everybody in this movie had blue eyes, and suddenly it drove him crazy. So he decided that the actor who played Masala had to be brown-eyed. Somebody had to be brown-eyed, and he was chosen to be the brown-eyed actor, and he had to wear contact lenses.
Well, we were rascals, weren't we?
No, you were good boys. I would have that time again.
Martha Scott was cast as Miriam, Ben-Hur's mother, a part she was familiar with, having played Charlton Heston's mother 3 years earlier in The Ten Commandments.
And yet, why is it? I'm not afraid anymore.
Ben-Hur's younger sister, Tirza, was played by Kathy O'Donnell, William Wyler's sister-in-law.
She had a particular quality of innocence and naivete, actually through her whole life, that most people lose by the time they leave their teens, if not before.
He hasn't changed, has he, Mother?
What? Yes, yes. Yes, I love you too, as my good Aunt Alice.
Hugh Griffith won an Oscar for Best Supporting Actor for his performance as Sheik Ilderim.
4-1, Sheik. The difference between a Roman and a Jew.
Or an Arab.
Bravely spoken.
The highly acclaimed Jack Hawkins plays Quintus Arius, a stern taskmaster who, through a twist of fate, would come to adopt Ben-Hur.
Now listen to me, all of you. You are all condemned men. We keep you alive to serve this ship. So row well and live.
Haya Hararit was cast as Ben-Hur's love interest, Esther, seen here in a makeup test. Hararit was born in Palestine and, in fact, was the only non-American actor cast as a Hebrew.
You love this man.
I will learn to love him.
British actors portrayed the Romans.
The grown man knows the world he lives in. And for the present, the world is Rome.
The Romans were the aristocracy of the time. So they spoke in what we sort of think of as the more aristocratic English.
You have become the victor and hero to these people. They look to you, their one true God, as I called you. If you stay here, you will find yourself part of this tragedy.
In the middle of the picture, Sam Zimbalist dies. And Ben-Hur killed him, just the sheer pressure of that movie.
Sam Zimbalist dropped dead one day of a heart attack. I think that the pressure, which was already severe because Ben-Hur was designed to save MGM Studios at the time, well, the pressure just mounted exponentially when suddenly the producer was no longer there.
MGM turned the overwhelming production over to William Wyler and J.J. Cohen, who 33 years earlier had helped make the 1925 Ben-Hur film a success.
I was the only dog around, so I took charge. Authority is something you take. They don't give you.
I remember my father saying that there, not a week went by that someone didn't appear from the Home Office in Rome to see what was going on. He was under intense pressure all the time.
Judah!
One of the sources of that pressure was the religious aspect of the story.
I have found him. The child has become a man, and the man, oh, I know it now, is the Son of God.
The studio had called in consultants from the Vatican, as well as representatives from the Protestant and Jewish faiths.
The 59 version of Ben-Hur, as opposed to the 1925 version, the stage version, and the novel, was a little more on the vague side with regard to Judah Ben-Hur's conversion to Christianity. It was very direct in the earlier versions. Christ is on his way to the cross and would cleanse the lepers and performs other miracles and so forth. in the 59 versions, it's indirect. We have the big storm and so forth, and then the family no longer has the leprosy. But there is no overt conversion. It's more the brotherhood of man kind of thing that he is embracing and that the family is embracing. And that was probably done because of the changing times.
The studio was especially concerned about the treatment of the Christ figure.
Well, he had something in his mind as to how the man walked with dignity and that sort of thing. And with a man like Willie Wyler handling it, it wouldn't be anything but dignity.
You! I said no word for him!
The sort of subtitle of Ben-Hur is A Tale of the Christ. It was one of the things that really was a challenge, and to portray the Christ is something that's a bit scary, you know, when he may be the best known man who ever lived. So I staged all the scenes with him in such a way that you only saw the back of his head and you saw the way other people reacted to him. You think you saw him, you think you heard his voice, but you didn't really.
This rare costume test reveals the face of Claude Heater, the actor who portrayed Christ. To embody the passion of Christ, Zimbalist and Wyler called on renowned composer Miklos Rocha for a masterful music score.
In responding to the challenge of the picture in terms of his own spirit, I think he came close to the soul of the movie. It's a combination of many things, and it is the province of music which can do that, I think, better than almost any other of the ingredients.
I can't say enough how important I think music is to a picture if it's done properly. And so did William Wyler. In fact, we changed the cutting in some sequences to fit what the music would be.
Those are very powerful scenes between, I think, Stephen Boyd and Charlton Heston. And there you have to accentuate the underlying combination of what was formerly affection, love, and respect, and the change to this hard attitude.
Not only the music sets the mood and atmosphere of a film, matte paintings can also transport the audience to another time and place.
Matte shots, basically the means of painting in part of a scene that you don't have to build. And you could create a shot that would give the film an incredible sense of grandeur.
The producers used this technique to cut costs in shooting much of the parade sequence.
There are scenes where the Roman legions are coming forever, it seems as though. And in fact, there were only 40 or so troops that were used for that scene, shot in different positions and then reduced and put back into the distance.
Matte paintings were also used to make the Circus Maximus appear larger than life. Here, without the paintings in place, modern Rome is visible in the background. This is the way filmmakers envisioned the Circus Maximus in all its magnificent splendor.
Ben-Hur was shot in what they called camera 65, that is a 65 millimeter camera. The image is something like almost four times the size of a normal release that you see in most movies today. It also had what they called an anamorphic process that stretched the image, so it was almost 3 to 1, three times as wide as it was high, which also gave the chariot sequence, for instance, the grandeur that it had, because you could see so much action happening at once because of this incredibly wide frame.
The massive chariot sequence took a full year of preparation and required the best stuntmen Hollywood had to offer.
We went over in February. It was about probably 4 months preceding the filming or the beginning of the race. And worked on the teams, drove the chariot teams, and got them down to where he could handle them and they were fit for a race. During that period of time, we set up a time in the morning wherein the actors that were involved in the race could come out and drive and get familiar with the teams themselves. If an actor can do that, it'll enable a director to get in closer with a camera, and whereas with a double, he has to stay back further. And it was funny because the only one that ever showed up out there was Chuck Gustin, who was out there every day. And consequently, when the picture started, he could drive a chariot just about as well as anybody in the business.
But of course, when we found that Masala and Ben-Hur could each drive the chariot, it was pretty exciting because we could go in and get some good shots.
Even though Heston handled the horses with ease, for the more dangerous scenes, Joe Cunnutt still stepped in as Ben-Hur's stunt double under the careful guidance of his father, the highly respected second unit director, Yakima Cunnutt.
The one thing where the team jumps two wrecked chariots and Heston's supposed to ride it over and go on. Well, my son was doubling him. The thing had me a little bit worried because it could have been a pretty bad mix-up. So I went over and gave them all their last-minute instructions. And I told Joe, just have them wide open. Before you get there, settle the team a little so they can make a good jump so that keep them throwing you over the chariot. And he said, well, okay. And so I figured he'd bought my way. And when we started the scene, he come around in a beautiful turn around the corner and into the wall. And he hit this thing wide open. He never settled the team. And when the team just started to jump, he dropped the reins and both hands in front. Well, I just swallowed my head and rattled, and here goes the wreck. Well, it turned him a complete handspring over the chariot. And he managed to hang with one hand and get a hold of the hitch rail and turn a flip off into the spina wall. But in doing it, he got his chin cut there, a couple of stitches, and didn't really amount to anything. 30 minutes, he was back on the job working.
Now, people have asked me about somebody getting hurt and people being killed and on. Nobody was hurt, nobody was killed. It's a double for Ben-Hur. When that time when he went over the front of the chariot, that also was an accident. So he just went in and shot a close-up of Chuck Heston.
I had two trick things there that I wanted to give him the effect of somebody really being killed. I had the guards standing along the spina wall, and I put a dummy in between two of these fellas and had him hold them, and the teams come, and this team comes in close. They just shove the dummy over far enough that he gets hooked for the horse and it spins him, and then of course falls off and the next team runs over him. And then I had another one where the wheel come off and the fella drug behind the team and turned the chariot over. I had him turn loose, and as he started to get up, there was a team coming right at him, and he done a dive out of the way of that team, hit the ground, rolled, and ended up on his hands and knees, getting up in a cut. Then I moved in close, got the team back, and I put a dummy on a board on its knees right down to the ground to where I could trip it. And as I did, the spring would pull it up and it'd throw his arms up. Time that and put it in there, and everybody swore that it was a real man and got him hurt.
Not counting Masala, perhaps the biggest loser in the chariot race was one of the $100,000 65mm cameras, of which there were very few in the world.
Yeah, I have the distinction of completely demolishing the first 70mm camera. They had a scene where Masala and Ben-Hur locked together neck and neck and do a 180-degree turn around the end of the spina. They had a camera shooting toward the spina, so that when we come around the end of the spina, we go between the camera and the spina. And we tried it two or three times, and it seemed to work pretty good. But I don't know what happened. When they shot it, we came around the end of the turn, and just everything started drifting out. There was ground glass and film and cameramen running every direction. They're right over the top of their barricade. It's kind of a mess. We were very unpopular around MGM for a year or two after that.
The final cost for Ben-Hur, $15 million, the most expensive film made up to that time. The MGM epic would go on to earn $80 million.
The costliest motion picture ever made wins Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer acclaim for faith in an industry ever new and changing.
With the movie completed, a massive advertising and PR campaign ensued.
Coffee break with a star while waiting to purchase their tickets. A rare treat. The girls will hear about this.
Ben-Hur merchandise swept the nation. Everyone wanted something with a Ben-Hur motive.
At a reception before the premiere performance, Heston is greeted by the Ben-Hur of the 1925 silent screen version, Raymond Navarro. A nostalgic touch, and Navarro looks so youthful. 11 Oscars are won by MGM's Ben-Hur.
I would like especially to thank Willie and Christopher Fry and Sam Zimbalist, who gave more than any of us. Thank you.
It's full of life, and that was the Wilder touch. These aren't just cutouts. These really are people driven by powerful emotions, set in time.
When you had a script that was improved by Sam Zimbalist, when you had Christopher Fry entering the picture, you were talking about people who were good. You were talking about gods.
Today, more than 30 years after the final frame was shot, Ben-Hur remains one of the crowning achievements of the Hollywood studio system. The story that began in the mind of a Civil War hero more than a century ago still retains the dramatic power, the majesty, and the compelling grandeur that will thrill audiences for generations to come.
For the best of these, the crown of victory, the race begins.